Seeing none, thank you. And finally, Michele Hanash.
Thank you. Thank you so much for this opportunity to testify, and thank you for holding this hearing on this very important legislation. I'm Michele Hanash, Director of Policy and Women's Programs at AHA Foundation. We are a nonprofit working to end harmful practices like child marriage, and we also receive those help requests from people fleeing forced marriage, including minors. So we see also firsthand these devastating situations that primarily these girls are being placed in. So there are several reasons you heard today why child marriage is dangerous. And I'm going to speak just about one of those reasons why child marriage is inherently dangerous. And that is because of the devastating and lifelong repercussions, especially for girls. It's a violation of individual liberty, personal freedom, and fundamental rights. Child marriage destroys nearly all aspects of a minor's health, education, and economic opportunity. Minors who are married are more likely to experience physical and sexual violence. They're more likely to lose all sexual and reproductive rights, lose access to education, and live in poverty, and suffer additional instability and hardship. As you heard, 70 to 80% of child marriages end in divorce. And we know that a girl who's pregnant and married, her and her baby will both suffer much more economic hardship than a girl who actually is in that situation and stays single. So for these reasons, the U.S. State Department calls marriage before 18 a human rights abuse. And for these reasons, the government has no business being in the child marriage business. I wish I could say it wasn't happening with alarming frequency, but you've already heard the numbers. You've heard that 215 minors were married in New Hampshire between 2000 and 2023. You heard that 9 were entered into marriage just since the law was amended. 83% were girls wed to adult men. Again, this is a problem that is really, really damaging the girls of New Hampshire. And again, only 4% of the minors that were intended to be protected by that 2018 law were protected. As you heard, 96% of those minors were 16 or 17 already who were being entered into marriage. But again, the good news is that there is simple legislation that can fix this problem. And so that's why we're here asking you to pass SB 359 with the amendments Frady mentioned. This is legislation that harms no one, costs nothing, and ends a human rights abuse.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions? Senator Whitley.
You provided the committee this address.
Yes, but I'll be more than happy to. If you send me an email, we'll get that taken care of.
Thank you.
It's in the testimony that has been
changed. Okay. What's in here? Okay. We'll have to go through it. Okay. Are there any further questions? One thing I'd like to just ask, and I already know the answer. If a 16-year-old gets married and becomes a victim of domestic violence and they want to leave and go to a domestic violence shelter, are they allowed in?
What we routinely see is that because of the policies of domestic violence shelters, they routinely turn away unaccompanied minors for liability reasons, for other reasons. They do not take in unaccompanied minors. And this has been verified by the survivors that we work with who all were turned away from domestic violence shelters.
Secondly, if a young woman, age 16, who is married, is a victim of sexual violence, can they go to the doctor and be treated even though they are a minor? Is their spouse notified that they're receiving treatment?
So anecdotally, what I've seen, and I would ask Unchained to also weigh in, what we see is that minors, when they're married, are still treated like children. And whenever there's a guardian that's required to be present, they will act as if the husband is now their guardian. That would include, from what I've seen, even signing permission slips to go on a school field trip. I don't know if you've seen the same.
If you have a child who, say, comes to the hospital who's a victim of sexual violence, is child services notified?
So, again, and I'm speaking anecdotally, mm-hmm. Unfortunately, what I've seen is that a girl who has been raped, who would show very obvious physical signs, she's pregnant, for example, so you cannot, there's evidence even of the rape, law enforcement will not pursue that what could be a crime if the girl is married. What we've also seen is that Child Protective Services doesn't know how to handle a situation when a girl is married. So just the fact that a girl is married tends to make people step away and say, okay, she's married. There's nothing we can do about it. Whether that's legally true or not, practically speaking, people step away from the situation and say, she's married. There's nothing we can do about it.
Okay, thank you. Are there any further questions? Seeing none, thank you all very much for being here and for your testimony.
Thank you so much.
Okay, are there any other members of the public who would like to speak to Senate Bill?